This is apparently how some people see UV resin, like it's no big deal. Well, I disagree. This is orange juice, obviously don't drink resin. And this is the Prusa SL1. There we go. It's the resin printer from Prusa, and as such, it comes with quite some expectations, at least for me. But it's Prusa's first resin printer, and it wasn't even fully developed by the Prusa team itself. So let's check out whether they've still managed to build the MSLA equivalent of the ever popular Mark III and Mark IIIs, and how much the cleaning and curing station, the CW1, makes the resin printing process a bit more bearable. Okay, so first impression. What is the difference? Because the SL1 costs exactly 6.5 times as much as one of these, and the Mars is already a very usable printer. Actually, first difference is this thing is super lightweight compared to the SL1. So, but let's start out with hardware and specs. Size-wise, the SL1 has the same build area as almost all the other compact LCD-based SLA, aka MSLA printers. It's got a 5.5-inch 1440p screen that gives you a nominally 120 by 68 build area, millimeter build area, and the Z-axis goes up to 150 millimeters. That's small and limiting, but it does fit the majority of parts that I'm looking to print on an SLA machine. Then again, it's only when you have the options that your brain starts thinking about ways to utilize them. But the first and mechanically one of the best features of the SL1 is right here on the LCD assembly. It tilts. And apparently that helps with getting the cured layers to separate from that FEP film at the bottom of the resin vat. Resin printers are not quite as easy to watch as filament printers. You know, with an FDM machine, you can just look and observe what's happening as the filament is being laid down. With resin, the actual printing happens at the bottom of the resin vat, under all the liquid resin and under the build platform itself. So the only immediate feedback you get is listening to how the layer changes and that peeling noise sound. You can't totally watch what's going on, but we can still have a look at the result. And while we're seeing these random lines in the prints in the Mars, the prints from the SL1 are super consistent without any of those lines visible. So even though the tilting mechanism needs to be a super high precision part so that that position it returns to always ends up at the exact same height, apparently it does manage to do that and works really, really well. The rest of the SL1's hardware is very well made too. Everything's solid. But being a Prusa machine, and of course, Prusa are known for building their filament printers, their Mark IIIs, Mark IIIs, etc., the Mini, in the wrap style with a ton of 3D printed parts. So where are all the printed parts on the SL1? There's like two or three which are actually not printed on the SL1 itself, but instead on their Mark IIIs print farm. There's the screen bezel around here, the knob in here that holds the build platform, the print bed, and if I remember correctly, like a small bracket or something inside the machine. To me, that means one or all of a few things. Because it's more effort to change a traditionally machined parts, these parts probably have seen fewer revisions than what's on something like the Mark III. Then the SL1 might not be torture tested at Prusa as much as their Mark III and Mark IIIs fleet that racks up literally millions of printing hours every year, printing more Mark IIIs and Minis. Or it could be that the resin parts that come off of the SL1 either aren't durable, precise, or economical enough to be used in shipped production machines. The thing is though, the SL1 wasn't exactly developed by Prusa themselves. They actually acquired a separate company that had already developed an SLA printer, which then of course with a few adaptions became the SL1. So it's a bit of a different team that did the main work on the SL1 versus the i3 printers, and it shows. I built the kit version of the SL1 simply because I enjoy being able to see every bit of the printer and how it goes together. There are a lot of machined and custom parts in here. It's definitely well built, but I would not recommend going for the kit. It is quite a tight machine down here to work on, and honestly, if you're going for a premium resin printer like the SL1, you probably don't want to spend the time and effort to build it. And of course, in case you mess up, that's on you. The SL1 is still fully open source though, and while I don't think we'll see carbon copied SL1 machines anytime soon, it's still valuable to have all the effort that went into hardware, electronics, and firmware available to learn for everyone. Though it would still be nice to see if someone just went ahead and SLA printed all the precision parts and built an SL1 clone from that. Okay, a few more things that the SL1 does. It has a resin sensor that detects how much resin you've got in the vat. The way I understand it is that it actually uses the print bed as one side of a capacitor, and as it moves it down towards the resin, it measures how much capacitance that entire thing has versus the entire vat and tilt mechanism assembly. Either way, it works, and it's one of those smart Prusa features we know from the Mark III. It's also got Wi-Fi built in, which gives you a web interface for monitoring, integrates into Prusa Slicer for file uploads, and is used for firmware updates. Overall, the Wi-Fi networking is nice to have. I actually just ended up not using it. I'd take my USB thumb drive, this is the one that's included, and just walk over to the printer because, well, I need to do that anyways to start it. The way the printbed mounts to the Z-axis is also really well done. It clamps well, and there's no risk of changing the alignment of this ball head when you take off and reinstall the bed. Don't worry, this one has been thoroughly cleaned, like there is with some other printers, the Mars that is on the bottom here, where this ball joint assembly is a bit too loose and there's no good way to clamp it down really well. Also, the SL1 comes with an activated carbon filter on the back that is supposed to reduce that resin smell you get, especially once the fans inside the machine start running. It doesn't quite do as much as I had hoped it would. I know when I'm wearing my respirator with those organic vapor cartridges, those completely cut out any resin smell, but just relying on the filter in the SL1, the room still ends up smelling like resin. Not as much as with other machines, but it does accumulate, and I still wouldn't recommend using the SL1 in a completely sealed off room. Now, a few things are just a given with the Prusa machines at this point. Print quality is fantastic, in no small part because of Prusa Slicer and the fact that you get profiles for the SL1 and a bunch of different resins that are all set up and tested already. That works fantastically. And also, reliability and kind of the proofing against user error should be on point, and it is. There's double and triple checks built in for a lot of things that you as a user could mess up, and that's great. Reliability has also been on point with this machine for me. Now, when it comes to usability, it's got its ups and downs. The CW1 for me actually makes a massive difference in how much I enjoy resin printing in general. Yes, it can still be messy and all, but with the CW1, I find the post-processing steps a lot more predictable and get you more repeatable results. So, using the CW1, you start out with the container of IPA in the machine, and on the lid there's this clip for the print bed, and basically you dunk the entire print and print bed into the vat of IPA, this one right now is empty, and you start the stir, the washing cycle. There's a 3D printed impeller, where did I put that? Yep. Right in here, with an embedded magnet that swirls around the IPA and washes the print and the bed inside this container. And the cleaning results are pretty much always perfect. Then you take out the IPA container, this thing is heavy, from the CW1, try not to spill any, and either remove the washed print from the bed, or if there's no stray resin that's going to cure onto your bed, I often also just like to shove the entire bed with the print still attached into the CW1 for curing. The print is easier to remove when it's not cured yet because you can sort of peel it off, but you also run the risk of deforming it if you're not careful with it. The CW1 then doesn't just cure and expose the part with UV light, but it also has a not very powerful but effective heater built in that can evaporate the remaining IPA off your parts. I would highly recommend using that drying feature and maybe even drying it for a bit longer than you think you need, because any stray IPA will leave nasty marks on your part. But after drying, basically after a set amount of time at the drying temperature, the CW1 will switch over to the UV LEDs, which are nice and evenly spaced out all around. There's some in the back here, there are some in the arms up here, and you know, the part rotates the entire time while it's curing. They even LEDs in the base plate back here so that it can cure from below, but that does tend to leave an imprint from this hex pattern on your parts. In any case, the parts were always well cured once the cycle had finished. To be honest, I was more excited about the CW1 than about the SL1 itself. Even the cheaper resin printers are decent at this point. At the very least, they print with more detail than filament printers, but without something like the CW1 or a custom-built post-processing setup, it's a huge pain and mess to get your parts out. The CW1 does make the process a lot easier, but in itself, it's not perfect either. So, it's nice that they try to have a single machine do both the cleaning and curing, but having to move that tank that's basically filled to the brim with IPA. I've actually got the IPA that used to be in here, right here. So that's this much IPA that was in here. And you can see this stuff is saturated with resin at this point. You know, I'm just not comfortable maneuvering that in and out every single time. This container is basically filled to the brim once the IPA is in there. I'd prefer the cleaning station just to be its own separate unit, you know, essentially a magnetic stirrer that has an IPA tank solidly just mounted to it up top. A stirrer like that is basically a $20 eBay item. Links below. For drying and curing, it is pretty much perfect though. I'm not sure if it's worth the full 700 euros Prusa charges when you buy a CW1 without also getting the SL1, but the cheaper as a bundle. Now, a few more things you should know about the SL1 in no particular order. First, the LCD screen is warranted for 500 hours of use. That's about 50 to 100 prints. And if it fails after that, you need to buy a new one for $75. The replacement is relatively easy to do yourself, but for comparison, replacement screens for example, the Mars, are only 20 bucks. I don't know how long they actually last. I'm hoping the fact that the SL1 actually has a fan for actively cooling the screen from below might help with longevity. But still, in the worst case, if it ends up failing after 501 hours, it means you're paying about an extra buck per print in replacement screens. Then the resin vat. I've honestly really started to like the fact that I had more than a single vat for the Mars. Actually, let me grab this one real quick. There you go. This was an unused one. Having an extra vat makes it really easy to switch between different resins, even if it's just different colors, because you don't have to meticulously clean out the vat every time you swap. Elegoo have that 4-pack of vats for 40 bucks. So these are plastic injection molded ones. And yes, these really aren't available anywhere right now, and users are reporting issues with these plastic vats that will ruin your print experience, but it's about 10 bucks per extra vat. If you want an extra vat for the SL1, that's going to be 77 euros for just a single one. You can get them, they're just expensive. Next, print speed. And this is kind of a universal truth for all MSLA machines. The fuller you load up your print bed, the faster your parts are going to print, because it's a fixed time per layer, no matter how much material is being cured onto each one. And also, you don't get that sudden change in print finish at the exact height another print ends. The profiles for Prusa resin are tuned for fast print speeds, faster than you'd go on other machines and resins out of the box, and normal print settings on the SL1 have always ended up taking less or about equal time compared to filament printers, while of course delivering much better detail. Next, Prusa slicer for preparing your prints. It's good, it's very usable, the profiles you get are well tuned, but it's still not quite perfect. I found the automatic support placement to be a bit too sparse. I would have liked more but finer support material to actually get reliable prints. You can go in and manually place and remove support contact points, but that's quite tedious to do for every single print. Prusa slicer by default also lifts your model so that it's not directly contacting the bed anywhere, but instead suspended in support material. Also, one core feature that's missing from Prusa slicer is hollowing out parts, and I think that one just is essential for SLA. Something like this. You'd be absolutely mad to print it as one big chunk. It's a huge waste of resin and may even end up significantly warping. I actually had to manually take this model through mesh mixer, hollow it out, and add the holes for drainage up here and back there. That does work, it's just tedious. But stuff like this is hard to factor into a review because software can be updated. And in the case of Prusa, there is a track record of software being updated over time. Even the Mark II has not only profited from improvements to what used to be Slick 3R Prusa Edition and now Prusa Slicer, but it has also received firmware updates, even recently, that added new features and improvements. And I know that, for example, hollowing out parts is already being worked on in Prusa Slicer and probably will be out in a few months for everyone. But of course, it still sucks that the SL1 user experience still feels a bit incomplete right now. So, for my conclusion, let's start with the stuff that is not going to change. First, the mechanics in the SL1 are absolutely solid. Print quality is fantastic, reliability is great, and in combination with the CW1, it's a good resin print experience. The CW1, or some other cleaning and curing station thing, is a very necessary part of SLA printing. And the CW1 itself does a good job when it comes to the results, but it could be better for usability. When it comes to pricing for both the SL1 and CW1, you know, that might change in the future. But the thing is, without a new cost-down hardware revision for the SL1, I don't think we're ever going to see much of a discount. So that makes the SL1 somewhat pricey for what it is, even factoring the fact that it has that tilting mechanism and is overall nicely built. The CW1 also feels quite expensive if you buy it on its own. I think right now it's just shy of 700 euros. But if you're already getting an SL1, it makes a lot of sense to also get the CW1 at the bundled price. It's just not the same without one. For the things that are hopefully going to get changed and improved, a lot of the details about the SL1 software are just not quite at that level yet that I've come to expect from Prusa, especially given the premium price point Prusa proposes per printer. Perhaps, at the time that you're watching this video, just check the changelog of all the things that have been updated with the new software and firmware releases. So, that is my take on the SL1 and CW1. Personally, I do enjoy using it as is already, and as always, links are in the description below. Those are affiliate links if you buy a machine or parts through those. That helps me run the channel. As always, shout out to my patrons and YouTube members. The continued support from you guys is the reason I can do this in the first place. So again, thank you all. And for everyone else, still, thank you for watching. I guess I should point out that a lot of you still aren't subscribed. Subscribing is free, as is adjusting your notification settings. And yeah, that's it for this one. Hope you all have a great day, and I will see you in the next one.